Simon & Schuster Audio presents Skinnydipping by Bethenny Frankel with Eve Adamson. Read by January LaVoy.
Prologue. Where are the stilt walkers? Has anybody seen the stilt walkers? I'm calm, but I can hear the shrillness creeping into my voice as I picture the absolute disaster that will result if Andy doesn't show up soon with the damn stilts and the people to put on top of them. The stilt walkers are essential. The dramatic cherry on top of the charity carnival. The finale of Domestic Goddess and the deciding factor in the rest of my life. And isn't that typical? You raise $80,000 for charity. You erect a 40-foot tent practically single-handedly. You hire and coordinate 75 employees, and you produce the whole goddamn spectacle. And then your life hangs in the balance because of a couple of clowns on sticks. Meanwhile, the cameras are rolling and America is watching. My failure would make just as good TV as my success, so nobody cares whether I win or not. Nobody but me. And this is just what Sybil Hunter expects. I have to make this work. Somebody runs past, pushing a popcorn cart that dribbles grease along the floor. The amplifier blares circus music, then cuts out with a crackling pop. A chunky, squinting boy in thick glasses grabs my arm. Jerome, the facility manager's assistant I roped into helping me. He looks barely 12 years old.
The snow cone machine is broken, one of the ponies is sick, and somebody left the banner on the floor and it got trampled,
he says, pushing up his glasses nervously. Easy, Faith. Easy. You've done this before. I'd handled even bigger events than this, and disasters bigger than this, too. My eyes are fixed on the wide double doors standing open across the warehouse space, where Sybil Hunter stands, backlit, imposing. The evil overlord ready to rain terror and destruction on the final challenge of what has come to be, in my mind, a sell-your-soul-to-the-devil concept, reality television. I imagine her smirk, her lust for my failure. I'm barely noticing the cameras rotating around in front of us, though part of me recognizes that my alarm is being recorded for national consumption. Tears are welling up, but I bite my lip hard, reminding myself what Sybil told me during the middle of the season when my team lost a challenge and turned on me, the team leader.
A woman who shows weakness in this business won't last long.
Suck it up, Faith. This is it. Keep your eye on the prize. With a last glance at Sybil's Hitchcockian outline, I turn to the pimply kid waiting for instructions. They come out of me like machine gun fire. Call the vendor and demand another snow cone maker within 45 minutes. Get the sick pony out of here. Call a vet. Call the rodeo. Whatever it takes. Repair the banner. Just make it look good. And for God's sake, get Andy and Jody Sue over here now. I need my fucking team. He nods and runs off. I stare at my clipboard. The list of unchecked items is 3 times longer than the list of checked items. I persuade a man with a mop to clean up the grease that's trailing the popcorn machine. My eyes dart over the list, trying to prioritize at warp speed. Suddenly, Jody Sue, eliminated contestant and disgruntled team member, is in front of me.
I can't find Andy,
she says in her squeaky voice, her cleavage even more evident and elevated than usual in a bright yellow wrap dress with a plunged neckline.
I finished the caramel apples, the cotton candy machine looks great with the neon, and the programs were just delivered and they're perfect.
Show me, I demand.
She holds out one and I grab it.
The glossy, oversized program has saturated carnival colors, balloons, clowns, and a Ferris wheel on the cover. Good. Very good.
But Andy's still MIA,
she adds, shrugging. Where the hell is he? What could he possibly be doing with 5 stilt walkers in the middle of Manhattan?
I really don't know,
she says, shrugging again.
He won't answer his cell phone.
This is great. Just great. This is Sherry Jacobs' lucky day, I mutter.
I could just imagine Sybil Hunter fawning over my ex-BFF/archenemy and fellow finalist
as she pulled off her final challenge with typical high-rent perfection. I get a carnival, and she gets a baby shower for Sybil's pregnant cousin. A fucking baby shower. I can just see the fondant baby booty cupcakes and sterling silver rattle party favors and pink champagne.
They'll all act like best friends, trying to impress each other with how rich their husbands are.
And here I am, sweating it out, pit-soaked with swamp crotch, trying not to have an anxiety attack, and running on fumes both on this warped excuse for a television show and in my life, with just $87 in my bank account and a team that hates me. Everything depends on an out-of-control carnival about to go horribly wrong. I'm so damn close to winning, and I need that prize more than anything, more than anyone else on the show. I just can't bear going back to my so-called normal life. Now I'm sweating blood to make this event happen, and I can't even get some paid extras on polls to show up. Hell, I can't even get my whole team to show up. I look around. Total chaos. A group of union guys tries to unroll artificial turf into the same spot where another group is trying to set up the Ferris wheel. A speaker on the soundstage wobbles and topples over with a crash, nearly crushing the woman trying to secure it to the stand. I look at Jody Sue in despair. How are we going to do this? I say. How is this even possible?
Search me, she says. It's your challenge. I was eliminated weeks ago thanks to you, and I wouldn't be here helping you if it wasn't in my contract, because I think you're a bitch.
She smiles sweetly. I'm in this alone. It's a zero-sum game. Okay, Jody Sue, I say. Why don't you just go sit on your ass out of the way and get your cleavage ready for the stilt walkers? They're gonna have a great view. Her mouth drops open as I spin away and set off to track down Andy. Because if I don't find those clowns in the next 15 minutes, I might as well not even show up at the finale. As I storm past Sybil, she stands silently, critically in the doorway with her arms crossed. I can't help myself. What do you think, Sybil? I ask. Are you entertained? Is it everything you hope to see from me? Because you haven't seen anything yet. Part 1. Chapter 1. Who do I have to sleep with to get a drink on this plane? I called out the request randomly, hopefully, as passengers pushed down the aisle into coach, their suitcases bumping my arm. Some of them raised their eyebrows at me, but I'm used to that. I'm rarely what you would call appropriate, although what these people around me didn't seem to realize was that tequila is always appropriate. I just smiled at them. Besides, I couldn't contain myself. Just minutes before, I had been sitting at the gate in Kennedy, devastated, trying with every inner resource I had not to break down into tears in front of everyone, and dreading how I would tell my father I'd missed the flight. Getting onto this flight meant everything to me. Everything. I'd skipped college graduation to catch this flight, but last night I'd stayed out until 4 club hopping with friends I hoped never to see again, celebrating the end of my 4-year imprisonment at NYU. I'd gone home with some handsome, dark-haired Wall Street trader, who I then wrangled into driving me to my apartment, double parking out front while I ran upstairs to grab my bag, and pull off last night's sequined halter top and miniskirt in favor of a black jersey dress that didn't wrinkle too badly, then driving me to the airport. Heading toward JFK, I lectured him about how fast to drive and which route to take. He dropped me off in front of the terminal, not sure what to do about my tears and hysteria about missing the plane. What was his name again? Anyway, I'd been too late, or so they told me, until the woman at the desk called my name. Faith Brightstone, please come to the ticket counter. I was sitting right in front of her, for God's sake. Did she have to use the little microphone? Yes? What? I'm here, I said, jumping up and clutching my carry-on with suddenly renewed optimism. There's one seat left. Hurry. She pointed to the door. I sprinted down the jetway, nearly toppling off my sample sale Manolos with the 4-inch heels. The ones that had finally tipped my credit card over its $30,000 limit. I rushed breathlessly into the first-class cabin,
where a flight attendant with her hair severely restrained in a blonde bun looked me in the eye. And there was that moment when we both knew I didn't really belong in first class. I wondered self-consciously if I still smelled like champagne and sex. I pursed my lips to contain any telltale alcohol fumes and hoped the spray of Chanel No. 5 to the crotch had taken care of the rest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.